Hey, what's going on, everyone? I thought I would just make this really, really quick video just answering some interesting questions that I've had in my past few videos. So some of the questions I'll be covering from watchers of the YouTube channel are outsourcing content, whether or not gaining the snippet actually negatively affects your traffic. And then I'll also be covering other things such as whether or not I've had any failures in my SEO journey, how many articles were published in the first month, and I'll also be covering how long it takes to format articles and heaps of others as well. So I'll start with the first one, and today where I am, I'm in Australia at the moment. So we've actually been in lockdown for around 240 days combined. So I've got some extra time on my hands. So I thought this would be a really, really good opportunity just to do kind of like a bit of just something different for the channel. So I am going to try and record this in one go. So if I do make any mistakes or anything along the way, please excuse those. So the first question here is from Robert, and he is asking, what is your process for outsourcing content? This is my biggest hurdle I've been trying to overcome, finding great writers. Would love to hear where you find them. So for the longest time, I was using Upwork for around 4 years to find all of my writers. However, in the last year or so, I have found that the talent talent pool has been dropping off quite significantly. I'm not sure if this is the case with other people out there, but for myself personally, whenever I do post a job posting for, say, American writers only, I might get 50 applicants, and maybe only 10 to 15 of those applicants will only be American writers. So the screening process does take quite a long time. And as for the quality of writers on there, I have found that they have also been dropping off as well. So this has led me to gravitate towards other platforms, mainly the Pro Blogger job board, which I've actually been loving over the last 7 months I've been using it. And I also do use Writer Access as well, not as much as Pro Blogger. And I did know about Pro Blogger job board for a few years, but being a tight ass myself in nature, I was really reluctant to pay the $75 fee for putting the job post up there. But from my experience, I think it definitely is worth it. So as for my actual process of outsourcing content, it pretty much starts with the job post. So I'll put a ad out for writers in a specific location. So for me, I try to find American writers for this website that I'm doing the case study on. And then within that job post, I'll have the pay per word, the amount of words that I typically want from writers. So I tend to try and hire writers that can write more, around the 8,000 to 12,000 words per week. And the main reason behind this is that this allows me to hire less writers that can output the same amount of content. Because if I hire 10 writers that do 5K each per week, that just means I'm doubling the amount of administration, payments, all of that kind of stuff. So that's one thing that I do look out for within the job posts. And then I also briefly explain to them the position. Ideally, it's good to have experience in the niche, but it's also not critical as well, because if you're a good writer, then you have the skills to research what is necessary as well. And what I've also been doing for pretty much the longest time for screening my writers is to include maybe 2 to 4 questions asking them about their personal experience within the niche. So say, for example, you're doing a pets niche. You could ask them what your first pet was, and what was its name, what type of pet it was. And then you can also ask, what's your current pet? Why did you pick this pet? How did you get to own this pet? And also, for those that aren't familiar with the niche, you could also ask, if you were to own a pet, what would it be and why? So these questions pretty much work in two ways. The first is that if the person applying for the job doesn't respond to these questions, then I know that they haven't read the job post in full. And that's pretty much a red flag to me straight away, because if they haven't spent the time just to read a really short job posting, then from my experience, they don't spend the time reading through the SOP documents. They don't spend the time editing the articles, proofreading, and so on. So pretty much if they don't reply to those questions, I won't even reply to their posts. And then secondly, I find this is almost an early screening opportunity, because from those questions that you ask, they'll reply with their answers. And this can give you a really, really great indication early on just whether or not they're a native English speaker, their style of writing, if it's engaging, and also kind of just their broad experience within the niche as well. So that's pretty much how I go for screening the applicants, and then I'll give them a paid trial post, typically around 1,000 words, and then I'll get that back, review it, and send it back to them. And then I can just slowly grow out the team that way as well. So that's pretty much my process. It's nothing too fancy. I know there's many, many like more complicated ways you can do it, but I like to hire as fast as possible, especially when I'm starting new projects. So moving on to the next question. And this question is from Andrew, and he says, "Great job, mate. Thanks, Andrew. I'm new to the info content strategy and wondered what impact featured snippets have on traffic. Do you still find you get traffic on pages where you've won the featured snippet? Cheers." So I guess this is a question where it's really hard to measure unless you really dive deep into the Google Search Console and you somehow had a method of doing an A-B test where you had the featured snippet and then when you didn't, and you compared the traffic sources. But just from my own experience, I do find that getting the featured snippet does hurt traffic. However, it's kind of like a necessary evil, because if you're, say, on position 4 and someone is above you in the featured snippet, excuse me, even if that person or if the reader is reading that snippet, odds are they're going to go on their way and go do their own thing. But there's also the opportunity of people that want to learn more about the topic, so they are going to click on the snippet. And I have mentioned this in previous videos, and I think this is just the direction of SEO. And from a reader's point of view, it is a better user experience if the featured snippet is there, because I think that there's kind of two camps of readers. There's those that want the answer straight away. They just want that quick reference. And then there's also the reader that wants to dive deeper into the topic and learn more about it. So I think it definitely is worthwhile to have the featured snippet. And just for a quick example here, so I pulled this from the website, and this keyword has 6,600 monthly search volume from Keywords Everywhere, which does use the AdSense data. And I did confirm this just before making the video, and this question does have the featured snippet. Now, as for traffic, it has had 9,100 page views over the last 30 days. So as you can see, even with the featured snippet, I'm actually getting more traffic as the quoted amount. Now, one thing to keep in mind that typically from my experience, I do find that it's typically 2 to 4 times the actual volume of the keyword with all the variations mixed in. So I would say that I am giving some traffic away for free. But on the flip side, I do find I do get a boost in traffic, as I can really skyrocket my position and my traffic from going to, say, position 7 to position 0. So I hope I helped you with that particular question. So moving on to the next one from Greg, and he is asking, how do you organize all of the content on your website? Hard silos, soft silos also. Are you using WordPress tags and categories? Any help there would be great. So as for how I organize my content, I think in the second video, I pretty much laid out the whole entire map of how I structure the homepage, the pages, the categories, and also the archive pages for the website. So that might be a really good reference to check out. Now, as for whether I use hard silos or soft silos, I'm pretty basic. I just stick with soft silos. And the main reason is because if you're going to click on a link in the Google SERPs, I do find it is a lot cleaner for myself personally when I'm going to click on a website link to just have website.com/ why do pets eat chocolate or something like that, instead of website.com/pets/dogs/ why do dogs XYZ. So that's just my personal preference. I don't think there's any right or wrong answer for that one, but that's just what I prefer. And he's also asking if I'm using WordPress tags and categories. So I absolutely am using categories for my websites. I'm very pedantic with categories. Because if I have kind of random blogs or articles in the uncategorized category, they're kind of just out in the ether. They're not really connected to a subset of other related posts. So every single blog post on my website definitely is categorized. Now, as for WordPress tags, this is something that I'm actually going back into my older posts and working my way forward, because I do find this allows me to get more kind of relevant internal link opportunities within the tags, because you might see relationships between posts with tags where you don't see them within categories. And also, I do want to add more tags because I do plan on adding infinite scroll. So if you do have infinite scroll, you obviously want to show the most related content within that particular article. So I do find tags does work better in that situation. So moving on to the next question from Ibo-chan. I'm pretty sure I butchered that, but thanks for the comment. And he is saying, love your videos, man. Thank you for that. And essentially what he's saying is, I don't want to know niche, but how broad do you go? Like pets, birds, or parakeets level of scope? I want to diversify into an info site, but not sure how broad to go. So I see what he's done here. He's kind of gone from the bottom of the kind of broader niche and worked his way backwards from parakeets, birds to pets. So my answer is pretty much standard with what most others say out there, and that is to go as broad as you possibly can. So I definitely wouldn't even pick birds or parakeets. That's obviously way too refined. And you may think that pets is broad, and it is, but I would even go broader than that. So instead of having a domain name like petaddict.com, I would choose something like animaladdict.com, because this allows you to do pets, and say if you cover all of the low competition topics with all of the pets out there, maybe you've had the website for 3 years, and then down the track, if you have animaladdict.com, this now allows you to go even broader into maybe animals in the safari, like zebras, giraffes, rhinos, elephants, those kinds of things. And then you can even go one step further and just have a completely brandable domain name that isn't referencing animals or anything of the sort. It could just be something like, I'm not sure from the top of my head, but it could just be a random connection of words like lifewire.com or anything like that. And that could allow you to go even broader into, say, dinosaurs or any living thing, insects, anything like that as well. So I do recommend going as broad as you possibly can when starting out a website. And you can kind of work your way up and you can see how far you can push the boundaries from, say, pets, dogs, and then work your way up from there. So moving on to the next question from MT. And he is saying, in the first month of this site, how many articles were up? And then also, did your first sites fail or no? And where do you find writers? Which was covered in the previous question. And he also says, this video is very inspiring. So thank you for the question and the kind comment. I hope you have got some value from these videos. So as for the first part of the question, I think from the top of my head, I had around 60 to 70 posts published within the first month. And then from there onwards, I've pretty much done around 150 to 290 per month. And just within that first month, I was hiring writers as well. So the ramp up period was a little bit slower, but I've kind of reached a nice kind of level at the moment. And I am in the process of also hiring some additional writers as well. And as for the second part of your questions, did your first sites fail or no? So the first ever website I made actually wasn't a failure, and it's still running to this day. However, I have had many, many failures along the way. I've had websites that got penalized by Google. I had websites, many websites that were complete duds. I just picked the wrong topic and the wrong niches. And then I've also had websites that I've started and I've just given up on a few months with it, into the project. So I've pretty much had failures in every single category you can imagine. Now, as for my first ever website and why that was successful, it was pretty much just complete beginner luck. This was back in 2010, and I made a website based on an issue that I had. So this could be something like TV not working. And I pretty much read a blog post on how to start a website, and their recommendation was to pick an exact match domain name. So I went out and picked tvnotworking.com, and then I pretty much just wrote a 1,000-word guide because I was having the exact same problem, so I thought others would be. So I wrote this guide, a step-by-step guide on how to fix your TV that isn't working. And it just so happened that other people were having this issue, and that did receive a lot of traffic. And again, this was just completely beginner's luck. If I had written a topic on something that didn't gain traffic, then I think I wouldn't be doing SEO today, because I really had no idea what SEO even was, what it meant. I didn't even know that you could make money online. Now, once I did receive traffic to that website, I did put AdSense ads on, and then I did get my first couple of dollars per day, and that pretty much hooked me into this particular method of making money. Now, as for my websites, after that first ever one, I'd say around the next four or five were complete failures, because I really had no idea that you had to write on topics that people were searching for. So the next websites I made were just complete failures, as I really had no idea that you had to write topics on people, on things that people were searching for. So yes, I have had many failures along the way, and I'm sure I'll have many failures in the future as well. So if you are having websites that are failures, whether they've got hit by Google, you've given up on them, or they were just a wrong niche, then don't be too hard on yourself, because everyone makes these mistakes no matter how long you've been in the industry. So moving on to the next one from AA, and he is saying, this is great. How do you come up with 1,200 to 2,400 blog post ideas? How do you do your keyword research? So thanks for the comment, AA. So how do I come up with all of these blog post ideas? So referencing back to the previous question, I go as broad as I possibly can. So staying in line with the animals website. If I was starting a website on animals, I would pretty much Google list of animals. And then from there, I would go through each animal from maybe the most popular down to the least popular. And I would start doing keyword research on one particular animal at a time. So maybe I would start with dogs, and then within dogs, I could do the breeds of dogs. And then I can move on to cats, elephants, alligators, and things like that. So as you can imagine, there's hundreds of different types of animals. So even if I just find really, if I find 30 really good keywords for each animal times 100, then that's 3,000 keywords right there. And obviously you're not going to do this in one sitting. Pretty much all you have to do is find the keywords for that particular week or that particular month that you are writing or your team is writing. So it does sound like a lot of keywords or blog post ideas in the beginning, but if you spread this out over months and years, then it doesn't sound as daunting. So moving on to the second part of your question, how do you do keyword research? So I don't do anything special in my keyword process. I pretty much use the same tools as everyone else. So I'll go Ahrefs, Keywords Everywhere, Keyword Chef I've also started to use as well, and that's a really great tool that I've been using. But pretty much the main method that I use to find keywords is to actually go into the Google SERPs, and I'll just kind of start with the keywords, say dogs, go breeds of dogs, what they can eat, what they can't eat, lifespan, why is my dog doing this, and so on and so forth. And then I'll just keep going deeper and deeper down the rabbit hole. And while I'm doing this process, I'll have an Excel spreadsheet open in a new tab, because kind of once you get in the zone of finding keywords, you can kind of forget where you started and how you got there. So I do find that having an Excel spreadsheet just open in a new tab or window is really great just to find those ideas while you're going through the process. And then, you know, just using Google SERP, and there's many other great videos out there that you can watch. There's nothing really new that I'm doing. I'm just kind of going as deep as I possibly can and just being really patient with the keyword research as well. So moving on to my next question, and this is from Alone. And he is saying, I'm just wondering how long it takes for you to edit, format, an article. And he's saying, I'm taking around 30 minutes to add images, links, headings, proofreading. Am I doing something wrong? So definitely not. From my experience, that does sound about right. Depending on the length of article, it can take you from 15 minutes to 1 hour to format. And also, especially if you're doing proofreading as well, it can definitely take you within that time frame from my experience. So when I first started out, this was something that really did take a lot of time out of my writing time because I was working full time. So I only had a select amount of hours per day and on the weekends to write. So if you were writing 3 articles a day and it took you 30 minutes to format each one, then you potentially are losing 1 to 2 hours per day of writing time. So this was actually the first thing I ever outsourced, and it was really the best decision I made along my journey early on, because it allowed me to write more. And you can really find awesome virtual assistants out there that can format an article just for a few dollars. Now, if you value your time more than that, then it really is a worthwhile trade-off. And the first time I did this, it was a really, really amazing feeling because I got the virtual assistant to format the articles. And that means the next day when I woke up, all of the articles were already in WordPress, all of the headings were done, the photos and everything like that. So all I had to do was proofread and publish. And that was a really, really kind of amazing thing to do for me personally, because it really opened my eyes for leveraging money for time as well. So that's pretty much, that's pretty ordinary for formatting. So there's definitely nothing wrong about that as well. So moving on to the next question, and again, this is from Alone as well. And he is saying, what a day in your life looks like. How do you manage so many projects? So at the moment, I have been in lockdown for quite some time. So I am working from home at my home office. So pretty much we're constrained to a 5 kilometer radius of where we can go. So typically in the morning, I'll check my emails. And then after that, because I have posts that have been formatted the couple of days before, I'll always try and go and publish 10 to 20 posts from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. And then after that, I'll go and maybe respond to more emails and do keyword research for the next week as well. So pretty much if I'm not publishing content or doing keyword research, because those are the two things that I find move the needle the most, if I'm not focusing on those two things, then I'm pretty much wasting time. But in saying that, I definitely do check analytics every day, check the earnings, watch YouTube, that kind of stuff. And then also my girlfriend is also working from home. So we'll also go kick the footy on the oval or go for a walk down to the cafe, those kinds of things, as we're pretty restricted as to what we can do at the moment. But yeah, that's pretty much what I do in my life at the moment. It's really nothing too exciting with everything that's going on at the moment. So moving on to the next question from Baz, and he says, hi mate, amazing. Thanks Baz. Do you have any tips on writing research to speed it up, please? Also, how much do you pay per word, please, for outsourcing? Thanks. So as for the tips on writing research to speed it up, so I guess this is all individual, but for me personally, for writing faster or researching faster, I always find these subtopics for the article first before I even start writing any of the content. So say, for example, the article title is Why Do Beagles Eat Chocolate? I'll go and research all of these subtopics that I want within the article. I'll paste those into the Google Doc, and then I'll go and start writing my research. And I do find that is a really, really quick way on how to write it, as you already have kind of a rough outline of everything you want to cover, and then you can just have a window or tab in you open, and then you can research while you're writing as well. So the next question is how much I pay per word. So for the longest time, I was paying $25 per 1,000 words. And this was mainly because I was on a pretty tight budget when I was first outsourcing. But I do find that there is a trade-off in some cases, not always. You definitely can find amazing writers for $25 per 1,000 words. But I do find you have to be really patient, and 9 times out of 10, they are going to be new writers. So you want to try and get them as early on in their journey, and obviously treat them really well, pay them on time, so they're going to keep you as a client while they grow their client base as well. But as for how much I pay now, I'm pretty much paying $40 per 1,000 words across the board. And this is mainly because I am hiring American writers only. So they do demand a higher rate. And typically when I pay higher per word, I do find on average, this isn't always the case. I've definitely hired bad writers at this rate, but typically I would say that they do write in a better way. There's less editing and proofreading involved. And they also do kind of get a better idea of the writing styles early on, because if they're demanding that rate, then they've usually done this for quite some time. Now that can be a positive and a negative because they might be stuck in their ways. But if you're training someone early on, then you can train them to your particular method as well. But that's pretty much how much I am paying per word at the moment. So moving on to the next question from Gumball, awesome name. And he's saying, good Lord, amazing. What theme are you using or what theme do you recommend? So I pretty much swap between Studio Press, the magazine theme from Genesis, to Generate Press as well. I'm really surprised by how many times I get asked this question, because at the end of the day, the theme really isn't that important. I remember when I first started out, I spent days and days trying to research the best theme, and then I installed it. I wasn't happy with it, so then I went on another rabbit hole journey on finding another theme, and I pretty much wasted a couple of weeks, maybe even more, just trying to find the perfect holy grail theme, and it really doesn't exist. But I think that as long as it's responsive and fast and minimal, you're going to have a really easy kind of effortless journey with that theme. And even if you're using the free GeneratePress theme, if you're starting out, it's a completely free theme. And that's what I was using when I first started this website. And I know a lot of people out there are kind of worried about the security, whether or not it's actually worth it. From my experience, it definitely is. So if you are starting out, free themes are kind of good to start out with. But then I do typically pay the premium theme, just to have extra settings for maybe font size, colors and stuff like that. But again, it's really not that important. There's other more important things to focus on with SEO. So that's the last question for this video, guys. Again, I thought I'll just make this quick video because I'm kind of stuck inside today. It's raining outside and there's really not much to do. So if you did like this video, please hit the thumbs up. And also, if you do have any questions that you would like answered, please drop them down below, as I'll most likely be doing this on a monthly basis if you guys do like these videos. So as always, thanks for watching. I'll see you all in the next one.